Assalamu alaikum and good morning everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. As
hi, good morning.
I think we have all the attendees from various time zones. So in India, in Hyderabad, it's morning. So I hope everyone is safe and they are good, they are happy. And I'm quite sure you people are going to enjoy this session. And I have seen like various people, those who have an experience of 2+, 3+, 4+, 5+, 10+. So I'm quite sure you people are going to enjoy this session. And what I assume, you might have been following my video tutorials or YouTube channel or Manzoor the Trainer or Udemy. So I have all my audience from these sources. So without any delay, let's start our session. So before I start the session, let me clear few points. I have set all the audience on mute because we have started recording this session. So all the audience are on mute. If you have any kind of doubt, you can have a pen and paper along with you. You can note down that doubt. And you can send me a WhatsApp message out there. So I can handle your doubts at the end of the session. I will try to discuss what all the doubts that are related to our session. I'm going to discuss at the end. Why? Because a few of the doubts may get cleared by the end of the session. So you can WhatsApp me, because if you, or you can also type in the chat box, anything is fine. But we are going to take the questions or your queries at the end so that we can have our session smooth and we can move without any kind of interruptions. So let's get started. So I'm going to show you few optimization techniques. Basically, there are a few buzzwords of your entity framework. Like immediate mode of query execution, deferred mode of query execution, list, enumerable, queryable. Then we have lazy loading, eager loading, and all these things. So these things I'm going to show you with various permutation combinations and what is going to work how. So we'll see all those things. So prerequisites for this, you should have some work experience in entity framework code first, and you should have an understanding of writing link using lambda expressions. So I assume you have some understanding of these two things. So let's jump into the subject. We are going to take our very famous old scenario, that is organization management system. So in this, we have department, which has list of employees, and we have employee, which refers to a single department. In our scenario, what we have, department can have a number of employees and an employee belongs to a particular department. So when we have this relationship, one to many relationship, this is how we design our class. We'll have a department class, or you can say your entity, or you can also call it as FOCO, plain old CLR objects. Department has n number of employees, so we have list of employees, and employee belongs to a particular department. So we are going to code these two classes, and it is going to generate a design database in this way. Like, you will have department and employee table, and department ID will be acting as a foreign key. You can see this is the relationship. Then we will try to understand all the various things. Let's get started with this. So I'm working on Visual Studio 2019, and we are going to create a new project. And we are starting with console app. .NET Core we are going to choose. And I'll browse to a folder, Entity Framework, new folder, Webinar. Entity Framework Optimization Webinar. Now I'll say create. See, whenever I start working with my Entity Framework core, there are a couple of packages that I need to install. I'll just right click on my project and say manage NuGet packages. I'll just browse for. So these are the two packages that I need to install. One is SQL Server, and I'm going to choose 3.1.0. So we are going to work on Entity Framework Core 3.1.0. And you see this package is responsible for all your CRUD operations, creating database, performing insert, update, delete, like DB context. This class is available in this package. So I'm going to install this.
Binsu, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I'm not able to see any screens.
Screen, is there anyone else who is facing this problem?
Can able to see.
Yeah, I think almost all the people, they are able to see. Anyway, I'll just try to disable the screen and enable the screen, and we'll see if it works for you. So I hope for all it's fine. So you can see if it is working now.
I'm not able to see screen is right.
Yeah. We have a suggestion saying that you try to log out and try to log in or rejoin the session.
Okay.
Now, the next package that we are going to install, let us see we got whether we got this package or not. Yes, we got the package. And the second package that we are going to install is Tools. This package is helpful for us see first package we installed, and that package is responsible for connecting to the database and performing all your CRUD operations in simple words. And we are installing this package. This package we are see why are we choosing this? Just simply because what we want, when once we go for ASP.NET Core or ASP.NET MVC core and all these things. So I should have standard packages. So we are moving with 3.1.0. If you want to move with 3.1.2, you can also move with that. There is no problem. Now I'm going to install this. I'll say accept. Fine. So we got two packages installed successfully. This is the first step that we normally do. Now coming towards our class designing, let us start with our department class. So I have my code snippet ready with me. I'll say e.department. So I got class department, which has department ID, department name, description, and this is my primary key. I'll say show potential fix, go for data annotations, and let this class be table department, because I want to generate table with the name department, not departments. This is a simple thing. This is fine. Next, I'm going to add another entity, that is my employee. And here my table name will be employee. This is my primary key. And I have employee ID, gender, first name, last name, salary, and as I told you, department ID is foreign key from the table employee. So this employee belongs, sorry, from the table department. And this employee belongs to a particular department. So I will have a reference to department. And this is called as your navigation property. And each department has multiple employees. So list of employees. List is available in our generic, and I'll have employees. Now I hope there is nothing complex in this. I have simple class, department, and employee, and we have the relationship. Now, after designing all our entities, what do? We design our DB context. So we'll have our context class. Name of the context is webinar organization. Web org DB context. It is going to inherit DB context, which is available in the namespace Microsoft.entityFrameworkCore. And this is my connection string. So we are going to override onConfiguring method, and I'll say use SQL Server. This is my connection string. Let the database name be webinar org DB. So here we got our DB context class, and I'm going to add few DB sets. I'll say prop tab tab DB set of employee, and I'll say employees. It is going to DB context. Is the class which performs all your CRUD operations, which manages the connection string. So this is the connection string that we are managing. And in your class, it is employees property which performs the CRUD operation on employees table. In the same way, this property will perform CRUD operations on departments table. So that's it. This is our one-time design task. We got everything ready. Now our job is to generate database. So I'll just go for NuGet package manager, package manager console. First of all, I'm going to generate migration file, add hyphen migration. I'll say initial create. So if everything gets built successfully, it is going to generate a migration file. Migration file will have the information about the table's creation in your database. So it is going to generate table department. Department ID is of type integer, and it is identity column, starts with one. In the same way, employee ID is identity column, starts with one. So we'll have a little confusion if both the columns are identity column. What I will do, I will set employee ID, let it not go for identity. So we have option database generated, and here I can say database generated options dot none. So it will not make it an identity column. But what we need to do, we need to remove the migration that we added just now. Remove hyphen migration. See, all these things are available in the video links that I have sent yesterday, if you remember. So I have deleted the migration file. I'm going to recreate the migration file. So now you can see that for employee ID is not an identity column. That's fine. Now I'll say update database. So it is going to generate a database with all the information that we have in our migration file. So we got web org DB. I'll explore this. You have tables, department and employee table. Right click, edit top 200 rows. So we got the department table. Now I'll just try to add some records from other. For department, we have identity column. So we got few records, which has got mixed up. So let us code it. So you have to see me department testing. It's testing department. development. Its description, it's a dev department. Administration, yes, admin department. Quality control, we have production development department, we have, and let this department be QA, quality assurance. I'll copy this, paste it here. Department. Quality control department. PDG department. So that's it. We have few records with us for our department table. Now we have department IDs from 1 to 6. Now I'll go for entering some 100 records for employee table. So don't worry, I'm not going to hard code it. I'm going to generate script for this. I don't know whether you have seen this tool or not, data generator online. This is a good tool to generate dummy records. So employee ID, and employee ID is a number, numeric value, number range, and I want to start from 1000. Employee ID, want to start from 1000. To increment, start from 1000. So this will be the employee ID. First name, what are the fields we have? You can see that employee ID, first name, last name, gender, salary, and all these things. First name, names, and single name, any gender. Then we have last name, again it is of type names, single, any gender. Then we have gender is custom list. Male or female. So I'll add one more row. We have salary. Salary will be numeric. You can explore all these things. Number range. I want the salary of an employee to range from 10,000 to 1 lakh. Is there anything else left out? Employee ID, gender, first name, last name, salary. Now you have department ID. Add one more row. Department ID is again a number range because it is foreign key, right? So it should be from 1 to 6. Now I want to generate SQL query for employee table. Database is SQL Server. I don't want create drop and all these things. I want one insert query and I want 100 rows. So generate in page, I'll say generate. So this is the first step that we normally do we have our dummy records. I'll just go for new query window and I'll paste it and I'll execute it. And you should see 100 records. So you got the dummy information. I hope it's interesting. Now, coming towards our main topic. So these are the things you should know already. Now, if I want to work, I should start with my DB context. So web org DB context. I'll make an object that is DB context equals to new web org DB context. So I'm working with this web org DB context. You can do one more thing. Using so it will free the object. It will free the object once it is used DB context. So it will dispose the object. So instead of DB context, this object name, you want me to use something else. So instead of DB context, I will use my DB context. I hope it should not be confusing anymore. Now, I want all the departments. Or I want all the employees. Let us say I want all the employees. So I will say list of employee. I'll say employees. So here I'm going to get all the employees in my employees object. So I want to read it from the database. So my DB context dot employees dot to list. This to list is available in my link, so I need to add system.link. I'm going to iterate through all the records for each loop where e in employees. So now I am iterating through this employees object. So here I have all employees. Console.write line, I'll say all employees. So I'll simply say console.write line for dollar e dot employee ID, then e dot first name, then I will say e dot gender, finally I'll say e dot department ID. Simple thing, there is nothing complex in this. I'm writing a simple select kind of a statement and I'm trying to display all the records. I hope nobody should have any kind of doubt in this. Now I'll copy this, paste it here. Now I want all male employees. All male employees. So what I can do, I have employees object, in memory object. This is the employees object which stores the result. So what I can say, employees dot where x gives rise to x dot gender equals to male. X is an object which refers to employees. Now you can see that you have only males. You see all males. Fine. Now what will happen over here? Whenever you say dot to list, it will execute the query on the database. Now coming towards the real topic, whenever you say to list, so it will convert or it will execute the query at this point of time, and it will store all the 100 records in your employees object. Query will get executed at this point of time, and all the records are stored in employees object in memory. Now when you iterate, it is reading the objects from your memory. It is not hitting database at this point of time. And when you iterate over here, when you apply filter, so it is filtering the records from the memory. It is not executing this query on database again. Are you all getting the point? If you do not believe me, I'll show you. Don't worry. I have SQL profiler. SQL Server profiler. So using this, you can observe the query execution and all those things. I'll just go for new to the same database. Okay, fine. I'll say run. I'll minimize this, and I'll also try to minimize this so that we can observe both the things. I'll clear all the records. Fine. Now I'll put a breakpoint here. I'm putting a breakpoint here and a breakpoint at this for each loop and a breakpoint at this for each loop. Now I'll execute this. Now you see that we have to list, so it is going to execute query here itself. If it is executing query here itself, we call it as immediate mode. So wherever I define the query, I want to execute right there, so it is immediate mode. Now I'll say F10. Now you see that it is executing the query. Now I will say F10. Now it is iterating, so you won't see any kind of query execution over here. So I would suggest all the audience, kindly your mic on silent mode, mute. Fine. Now you see this at this point, else F10, employees. There is no query execution you see. You do not see any new query executions. This is the only query that got, see select, we have only one select. Now I'll say F5. Now you see even at this point it is filtering. You see your employee. You have all the 100 records. You see employee, all the 100 records. So it is filtering those records. So this is your immediate mode of query execution. I hope you understood the meaning of immediate mode of query execution. Now the next thing, see what will happen here. In this scenario, we are hitting to the database only once. We are hitting to the database only once. And we are making one query execution, that's it. And we have huge amount of data in our object and we are iterating through that object to get the desired result whenever and wherever we require. See here we have all males. In the same way, if we want all department ID one employees, so what I can say, x dot DID equals to one. That's it. So three different results, but we are hitting only once. So this is your immediate mode of query execution. The plus point of this scenario is you will have less number of hits to the database. And the minus point is your in-memory object is heavy. Your in-memory object is heavy. So there should be always a compromise between the size of the object or number of hits to your SQL server. So this scenario is good when you have huge number of concurrent connection. If there are n number of people who are accessing concurrently, so your database need to maintain so many connection, and from each connection it need to maintain so many hits if it is not immediate mode. So 1, 2, 3 query executions. So it is a huge job if there are 100 concurrent connections. So it may perform 3 into 100, so 300 query executions. So in that scenario, it is better to go with immediate mode of query execution, where your object size may be little big or higher, so you can increase your memory and you can go for that. Now the next scenario is deferred mode of query execution. Now what do you mean by deferred mode? I am not going to execute the query at this point. I am defining the query, that's it. I am defining the query. Because I am defining the query, it is not going to return list. So instead of list, I'll say enumerable. Or I can say I enumerable. So in our earlier case, we said list. Instead of list, I can also say I list. Instead of list, I can say I list. Why? Because list and I list are same. You can say that. See, I'll say F12 to list. List is inheriting I list. So same thing. Either you say list or you say I list. So I'll better say I list, because as per our runtime polymorphism concept, or the rule, we normally create the reference of interfaces, then we make it an object of its implemented classes. But anyway, because we are not executing, we will say IEnumerable. It means what? It will get executed whenever it iterates. This result iterates. IEnumerable, else F12. It has getEnumerator. So getEnumerator means it is going to execute at the time of iterations, enumerations. So let me again put a breakpoint here, breakpoint here, breakpoint here, breakpoint here. Now, can you tell me how many query executions we are going to have at this point? So in this code, how many query executions? Definitely we'll have three query executions, 1, 2, 3, because iterations are happening 3 times. So we'll have query executions 3. Now let me clear this everything. Now let me execute this. Now here we are defining the query, that's it. We are not going to execute it. Now you can see in your SQL profiler, else F10. See, no query execution. Else F10. Now you will see that it is iterating. You have a query execution, that is select. Now else F5. Else F10. Now you see that it is iterating again. Now you should find one more query execution. So there is another query execution, select clause. Now I'll say F5. Now I'll say F10. So there is one more query execution. Say F5. Are you all with me? Have you understood the difference between immediate mode and deferred mode? See, in your immediate mode, you execute the query wherever you define. Now, to execute the query, you need to call any link method like .toList or .count, anything. When you call any link method, the query gets executed. So we call it as immediate mode of query execution. But when you call, when you do not call any method, so query gets executed whenever we iterate. Now what will happen here? In this scenario, normally we need this scenario I'll give you one more example here, or one more point at this position. What is the difference? One difference is, in your earlier case, you have one query execution and your object was heavy and you are carrying that object. Now here your object is empty. Whenever we need, we are filling that object. Whenever we iterate, we are filling that object. This is one point. Another point, if you observe in this, we have three query executions. First, select star from employee. It is similar to that. Second, again, that is also select star from. Third, that is also select star from. So what is happening with your IEnumerable is that every time it is getting all the records and it is filtering the records at the client. Every time it is getting all the records and it is filtering the records at the client. Getting all the records and filtering the records at the client. That is one of the drawbacks, you can say, of your IEnumerable. So what I can do, instead of IEnumerable, I can go for IQueryable. Now IQueryable is a pure query. And you see the difference now. I'll say F5. No query execution at this point. I'll say F10. There is a query execution. Select start from employee table. It has selected everything because we want everything. Now, this scenario is very important. Here you see the query. Now it is filtering the records on the server side. So huge amount of data will not travel over the network. And my object will have only that data what we need at this point. Now I'll say F5. This will give higher performance than you compare to your IEnumerable. IQueryable will give higher performance. Now you see at this point, it is going to execute another query. Now this query, it is filtering based upon department ID. So it is kind of pure query. Have you understood the difference between IQueryable and IEnumerable? In your IEnumerable, it will get all the records from your server and it will filter them on the client. In your IQueryable, it will filter the record on the server itself and get the desired records to the client. Now, do anybody have any doubt in this? Have you understood the difference between immediate mode and deferred mode? ILIST, IEnumerable and IQueryable. See, you might have understood the difference between IEnumerable and IQueryable. Now, what is the difference between ILIST and IEnumerable? I'll just explain. I'll comment it
out. I have a question.
Yes. See, you can do one thing. You can type in your question in the chat box. We'll take all the questions at the end. Because I'm not that. Your question answer may be the point that I'm explaining now. The answer to your question may be this point. Fine. Now, I will say IList. Whenever I say IList, I should say dot to list. This is fine. I'm executing. I'm getting all the records. Now, I can also say IEnumerable here. I will execute. I'll get all the records. If your result you are storing in IEnumerable, you can make it immediate mode or deferred mode, whatever you want. But my suggestion Whether it is immediate mode or deferred mode, always go for IEnumerable. Why? What is the difference between IEnumerable and ILIST? What is the difference between IEnumerable and ILIST? See, the difference is this. If I say ILIST, I got employees. Now what I can do, employees dot, I can add any record here. I will say new employee ID equals to something, employee first name equals to XXX, employee last name equals to YYYY. Employee gender equals to ABC. Salary equals to this. Then department ID equals to 45. Now, my question is, will it display this record when we iterate through all the records? You can type in yes or no. Yes, Sazi is saying yes with 2 S. Let me execute. We got the record 5555X. So it is displaying. Now my next question, is this record available in the database?
No.
Not at all. This record is not available in the database. So what are we doing? We are trying to break the application. So our application is getting broken. So we are, see, developer, see, you can see this. This is your data access layer, you can say. And you are giving rights to the developer to modify the data, whatever they are getting. So if it is ILIST, you can add, you can remove a record, you can update a record, you can do all these things if it is ILIST. But this should not happen, right? Is it not? This should not happen. So what I can do, instead of ILIST, I will say IEnumerable. Now if I say IEnumerable, you can see that it will not allow me to add. It will only allow me to iterate. So IEnumerable is read only. I can only iterate. So that's why whenever we design our classes, instead of list, the best practice is IEnumerable. Because IEnumerable will allow you to iterate through the records, and that is what our need is. We don't want to add any records with these employees. Whenever I want to add records, I will use the object of DB context and I'll use this DB set employees to add the records. So this employees I need only to iterate through. Now you see that you cannot add the record. Now if you want, I'll just go to IEnumerable, I'll say F12. You have only get enumerator, you can iterate, that's it. Get enumerator, you can iterate, that's it. If you go for ILIST, else F12. You have insert and remove. So you have both the things. ILIST is being implemented by list. You can see list will have all those things. Add range. Is it not? Remove all, remove at. So the best practice is always go with IEnumerable. Have you understood this point? I hope you people are not getting confused. If I say IEnumerable, I can make it immediate mode with toList, or I can make it deferred mode without toList. And it is best practice to make it IEnumerable so that it will be read only. And whenever we design the classes, we say IEnumerable. And you know, this has some name, and we call it as iterator design pattern. Have you heard about iterator design pattern? This is what your iterator design pattern is. So I have designed my application with a pattern that is iterator design pattern. So that means what? All my properties, reference properties, are IEnumerable. Now let us, is this clear? Now let us go to our PPT and see this. Immediate mode versus deferred mode of query execution. In your immediate mode, in immediate mode of query execution, query gets executed wherever the query is defined, and it is normally achieved with the help of link method like toList or count. Here, query object holds the data, which reduces number of hits to SQL Server on every request. Return type can be list or IEnumerable. For immediate mode, return type can be list or IEnumerable. We have seen just now. Next, deferred mode. In deferred mode of query execution, query is executed whenever we use it, like when we access a field or iterate through a list. Whenever we access a field or iterate through a list, when we use it, it gets executed. Here, query object hits the server on every request, which reduces the size of query object. See, in our earlier, the size will be heavy, but here the size will be small. And the return type can be IEquerable or IEnumerable. Now, what is the difference between IEnumerable and ILIST and IEquerable? Yes, I am going to share the PPT, don't worry. IEnumerable is read-only, whereas list is not read-only. I hope you got all the points cleared over here. ILIST, IEnumerable, IEquerable. ILIST, you can perform insert and update on ILIST, and it is used for immediate mode of query execution. You cannot use ILIST for deferred mode of query execution. One point. Second point, IEnumerable is read-only list. It can be used for both immediate mode and deferred mode of query execution. And IEquerable is also read-only. IEquerable is also read-only. And it can be used only for deferred mode. And one more point, in your IEquerable, data is filtered on the server, not on the client. So this is all about your immediate mode, deferred mode, ILIST, IEnumerable, IEquerable. And I hope you understood this. So till this point, if you have any doubts, I'll take your queries now. I have tried my level best to make it as simple as possible. Why can't we have identity column for both the tables? Is there any reason? No reason. Normally, if I say department ID is again starting from one and employee ID also starting from one, we'll have some confusions. Normally, your employee ID or department IDs, they are not identity columns. We make identity columns in your transaction tables because your employee ID will have some EMP-1 or something. So that's why it is not a good practice. Option builder is an object that will have various options like
then return.
So
when return type should be iQueryable and when it should be IEnumerable.
When the return type should be iQueryable or when it should be IEnumerable. See, as I told you just now, if you want to go for immediate mode, then you cannot go for iQueryable, right? Only IEnumerable. But if you want to go for deferred mode, then you go for iQueryable. And it all depends on your requirement. Now, see, immediate mode, my suggestion for immediate mode, if you have less number of concurrent connections, less number of concurrent connection, then you go for deferred mode because concurrent connections are less. So whenever we need the data, I'll hit the server, I'll get the data. My object size will be small. If you have more concurrent connection, then I will go for immediate mode. Why? Because in your more concurrent connection, I don't want to hit the data again and again. And I don't want to face connection pooling problem. See, one more thing that we need to understand here is there is no thumb rule. Nobody can say immediate mode is good, deferred mode is bad. And nobody can say deferred mode is good, immediate mode is bad. No. It all depends on our requirement. Now, normally, what I suggest to my developers, if you have a huge number of records, then your object will be very heavy. So let us go for deferred mode. If number of records are not huge, you have very less, like 100 or 200, not millions. So let us go for immediate. And at last, you now you have an idea of all these things, immediate mode, deferred mode, and your iQueryable, IEnumerable. You try out with various permutation and combinations on your database and check out the response time. You do a load testing. Normally you'll have testers. You do a load testing and you go for performance testing and choose the best combination that you want. But as an overview, normally what we do, I'm just suggesting those things. If you have less number of records, go for deferred mode. So go for immediate mode. You have less number of records. Let us hold the records in the object. It will be fast. You can read the data from the memory itself. If the number of records are very high, so your in-memory object will be very heavy. So that may affect performance for other users. So in that scenario, let us go for deferred mode, where you have a huge number of hits to the database. So always, depending upon your scenario, you try out what suits you best. So we have two things to note. One is the number of records, another is number of concurrent access. So nobody can say that, you know, this is good and that is bad. It all depends on our requirement. So I have shown you all the combinations. If I use SQL Server from other machine via internet or Android, yes, use it. There is no problem. Why can't we have, can you name the object something else? What is the difference? Got the difference, but in which case? Yeah, I think I answered this question. Got the difference, but in which case, which one to use. So you have all the scenarios. Based upon the scenario, you need to choose one. Yes, I'm going to share the PPT. iQueryable from server. From server means iQueryable will filter on SQL Server. iEnumerable client filter. Meaning, see, meaning is this. I'll just try to explain with a diagram. You have SQL Server, right? Database. And you have your application, data access layer. Now you are looking for employee with department ID equals to 1. Employees with department ID equals to 1. When you make a hit for the employees using iEnumerable, so it will take all the employees from the database and bring it to your data access layer, and it will do filtration over here. From employee, it will look for department ID equals to 1. So from server, it is carrying all 100 records and filtering here. This is iEnumerable. What will happen in iQueryable? In iQueryable, it will filter here. It will say E and it will look for DID equals to 1. It will filter the records on the server, SQL Server. SQL Server. And then it will return the results. I hope this is more clear now. You can see in the SQL profiler. See this, it is filtering on the server. So this query is getting executed on SQL Server, filtering based upon department ID. So filtering based upon department ID. So filtering on the SQL Server. What is the difference between iQueryable, iEnumerable? I hope you understood all these things. In the typical scenario where the hits are made by multiple users from multiple location, does immediate mode of mode still stands good? See, if you have multiple users from multiple locations, yes, that is fine. I'm talking about concurrent. When there are concurrent, it is not good. Yes, we are going to have this video recorded. Yeah, see, we are talking client and server means here server is SQL Server, client is your data access layer. In your web application, when I say client and server, your server is your IIS and your client is your web page. So this difference you should have. So I hope you got this point. And this is what we have: immediate mode of query execution. When you say dot to list, query gets executed. It will not hit SQL Server. It will not hit SQL Server. You are filtering based upon department. This is your immediate mode. In your deferred mode, and you see the best practice is iEnumerable. You are storing it in iEnumerable. In your deferred mode, it will hit SQL Server. Here it will hit SQL Server here, and here again we are storing it in iEnumerable, but the best practice is store it in iQueryable. So whenever we have deferred mode, is this clear? These two things, are these two things clear?
Yes, Manzoor.
Very good. So we are done with half of our session. So now what we will do, we'll take a break of 10 to 15 minutes. Then we'll start with our next topic, that is eager loading, explicit loading and lazy loading. So till then, I would suggest you to leave your honest reviews about this session that we are attending, or you might have already gone through a lot of my video tutorials on YouTube, on Udemy, on Manzoor the Trainer. So in the break, kindly leave your honest reviews, and those who have already left the reviews on, these are Google reviews. So those who already left the reviews, no problem. But in this 10 to 15 minutes, I want you to leave the review. I want honest reviews. I don't want 5 stars, or I don't want you to search some review on Google and copy paste. What you feel from your heart, you write it. And PPT, I'm going to share it in WhatsApp group, and I'm going to make this on my MTT portal and share the link on WhatsApp group. Everything, you'll get the video, you'll get the PPT, you'll get the source code. Don't worry about all those things. So we'll have a break of 10 to 15 minutes. So I would suggest you to leave your reviews using the link that I have shared in the chat. So welcome back. Hope you might have left the reviews, and those who are not done yet with the reviews, I would suggest them to, you know, complete it at least by the end of the session. So let's move ahead for our next topic. That is your eager loading. Explicit loading and lazy loading. I'll just comment out all those things. Right click, snippet, surround with, hash region, immediate mode versus deferred mode. This is the package that we are going to use in future, so I have just pasted it here, so don't worry much about that. Copy this. Fine. Now we have our see, are you all back? I hope everyone is able to hear me.
Yes, Manjur.
Very good. So let's get started. So I'll make it immediate mode of query execution. So I'll say dot to list. Now I am trying to, so because it is immediate mode, I should go for IEnumerable. Now I'll say 5, so I should get all the records. So I'm getting all the records. This is fine. Now Okay, I'll show that, no worries. That is an extra topic. I will deal with that topic at the end. So now I will say, instead of department ID, I want to show E dot department dot department name. I want to show department name. And this is the advantage of relationships. Or you can say the advantage of navigation property. This is how we navigate, right? From employee, if I want to navigate to department, I'll use this department object and I'll go to department and I'll take department name. So I'm displaying employee ID, employee first name, gender, and I want to display department name. Now, instead of taking all the records, I want to take only just take 10. So it's like top 10 records. I want to take only 10 records. So I want to display department name as well. Now let me see what happens. Now, what do you think what will happen? So it is throwing an exception. Why? Let us see that. Let us observe this employee object. Crash, exactly. Crash, fine. Now, if you see this employee object, we got 10 records. That is well and good. Now, in each record, you have employee ID, first name, last name, gender, salary. Department is null, you see that. We are loading employees, we are not loading its related records. We are not loading departments of employees. So that's why this department object is null. So you cannot have department name. If you see link hub, one of my link hub Manzoor the trainer. It has been a long time I visited this linkup.manzoorthetrainer.com. This is the live project on MVC entity framework and everything, entity framework core in both the technologies, in .NET framework and .NET core technologies, step-by-step procedure. So here, if you see, I have browse URLs. Maybe here or somewhere. See, I have URL title, URL name, URL description. Normally, URL title, URL name, URL description, you'll get it from URL table. And URL table will have a reference to the category with category ID. So URL table will have category ID. So this URL belongs to a particular category. So at this time, what I want to do, I want to display URL ID, URL title, URL description, and a category. To what category does this URL belong? If I display your category ID, it is meaningless, right? I'm showing you the real-time scenario. You want to display the information. I want to show the category name, so I should navigate from URL to category table. The same scenario here. I should navigate from employee to department table. So to do this, I will say that while loading employees, I want you to include x gives rise to x dot department. While loading employees, I want you to load all the related departments. We call it as eager loading. We call it as eager loading. Now let me execute and check. So we are successfully getting the departments. Are you all with me?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you want to see the query executions? Yes, I'll show you. First of all, I will not have any kind of loadings. This is a normal query. But immediate mode of query. I'll execute this. I would suggest you to mute your mics. Fine. Now you see this, the query as F10. Simple query, right? Select star from employee table and salary. We have that set. Simple query. And we are taking 10 records. It is taking top 10 records. Now, what I will do, I will try to make it eager loading. At the time of loading an object, I am asking them to load all its related objects. And I'll say 5. Now you see the query. And I'll say 10. Do you see that? Now my query is different. We are also selecting departments, inner join with departments. It is writing a join query for me so that I can get department name, description, everything. So this is the concept of eager loading. Have you understood eager loading? Now I want to go in the reverse process. Reverse process in the sense. Say I want to load department, IEnumerable department, and I will say departments. So I will take departments and I will say include employees and I will have everything. Now in our earlier case, employee is referring to single department. In our earlier case, employee is referring to single department. You see this. Employee is referring to single department. So what we said, e dot department dot department name. Now in this case, department is referring to list of employees. So department. Now what I can do here, I'll say all employees department wise I'm trying to show. I will say department D, and here I will say D dot, sorry, in departments. We are iterating through all the departments. See, simple thing, don't get confused. Earlier, we were iterating through all the employees. So we are getting all the employees. Now we are iterating through all the departments. So we are getting all the departments. And I want to load all the employees of each department. Now here I will say all employees department wise. Fine. Now console.writeline in string interpolation, we call it as d dot department ID and what I want d dot department name. That's it. These are the two things that we want. So this is fine. It is displaying all the department. That's it. It is displaying all the departments. I'll put a breakpoint also if you want. It is displaying all the departments 1 to 6. I'll execute. We got breakpoint. Now you see departments. You have 6 records, 6 departments. Department ID, department name, decision. And it is also loading all the employees of that particular department. You see that? Are you all getting? It is loading all the employees of that particular department. Department development has 17 employees.
Yeah, those 17 employees will have each department again inside that. Again, the department will have list. Will it go as a circular one?
Yes, it will be circular. So here we do not have any problem as of now. But once you go for converting it into JSON, then you'll have circular referencing problem, and we have some different solutions for that. So as of now, let us not go to that. So maybe by the end of the session, if time permits, I'll try to discuss even that. But here for now, let us concentrate on this. You got the department. Now I will say, for each where employee in each department, I want to iterate through employees, d dot employees. So I want to display the employees of each department. Is this clear? What are we trying to do here? Now here I'll just try to put a line so that we can understand the difference. Shift home, copy, just a little bit of formatting. I'll say 5. Now you see, you are getting all the employees department wise: testing, development, administration, QA. So this is your eager loading. I hope you understood the concept of eager loading. We use include to load the related entities. Now I will remove this include. I will remove this include and let us see what will be my output. There will be an error. Why? Because employees is null. Is it not? D dot employees is null. So what I can do, I can just put this in a condition: if d dot employees is not equals to null, so that our application should not break, because we are not including, so they are null. If they are null, let us skip that part. So you get the departments. Are you all good with this? Now what I want, I don't want to go for include and all those things. I want it to happen automatically. When I say d dot employees, it should load it here itself. So for that, I need to install this package, entity framework core dot proxies. Right click, manage NuGet packages, paste it here. Let us stick to 3.1.0. I accept. I always accept. And I'm quite sure nobody reads and they go for accepting. Now, what I will do, now I'll say option builder dot we have use lazy loading proxies method. Use lazy loading proxies. Now it will automatically load the related entities whenever we need it. It will load automatically the related entities whenever we need it. Now let me execute and see if it works or is it going to throw some exception. I'm just trying to explain some concept, internal concepts here. Now first of all, let us see the navigation property employees on entity department is not virtual. This is the first point. Use lazy loading proxy requires all your entity types to be public, unsealed and have virtual navigation property and have a public. Means what? We have some predefined classes which is going to or which is trying to implement these employees. So department is being inherited by department proxy and they want to overwrite this. So if you want to implement overriding concept, it should be a virtual. This should be virtual. So public, virtual, IEnumerable. Now we are getting one more rule. Whenever you design a class in your entity framework core, let all your navigation properties be public and virtual so that somebody can override it. So department is being inherited by department proxy and they are implementing this employees property. Same way employees being inherited by employee proxy and they are overriding this department property. The virtual, now what is a virtual method? Virtual method is a method or a property that can be overridden by the derived class. So your lazy loading, so proxy classes, they are trying to implement this department and they are trying to override it. When they are trying to override it, they see that it is not virtual. So it is throwing an exception. To override, it must be virtual. Now let me execute. Now let us see what it says. You got the result. You got the result. Now I'll put a breakpoint. This is called as lazy loading. Now why are we calling it as lazy loading? Let us see that. Now I'll say F10. Now you see department. Do you see department proxy? Department proxy means it is inheriting department and implementing the employees with employee proxy. So these are all internals. If you are very strong in OOPS, then you will get all these things. So now you see what is the query it has executed. Let me clear all. I'll go one step back. And I want to show what is happening in the SQL Server. Those who are in a hurry, they can leave. because this record is being this video is being recorded. We will end the session if even if the session we need to extend it for 10 or 15 minutes. Else F10. You see the query executed is simple query, select start from department, that's it. Now let's say F10. No query execution. Now we are iterating through. Employees. Say F10. We are getting the records. We got the employee. Now say F5. Now you should see this is what it one query execution for department ID 6, one query execution for department ID 5, one query execution for department ID 4, one query execution for department ID 3, one query execution for department ID 2, and one query execution for department. So if you see, there are a lot of query executions. Means what? It is lazy loading. For each department, it is executing a query. For each department, it is executing a query. Say F5. Because it is lazy loading employees, once we enter into the department, when once we enter this department, now you see that it has executed one more query at this point of time and it has loaded all the employees. At this point of time, it will load all the departments, and in this first iteration, it will take first department ID and it will load all the employees of that department. Now, if you see, now if I explore this, once I explore this, it is executing. You see this whenever I iterate, see it is executing. Now, whenever I iterate this, it is executing. When I iterate this, it is executing. And I iterate. Are you getting this point? I don't know whether you are getting the point or not. I'll just first explain here. Now I'll say F10. It has loaded only departments. It has loaded only departments. You can see this query got executed only departments. Now I'll say F10. Now at this point of time, it is iterating through departments. So it will execute employees with that particular department. Now you see execute taking time to display here. Yes, on demand you can say no problem. See, it is taking time. Anyway, our SQL profiler is not working as expected, but this is what happening. Just now we have seen that. So F10, now it will iterate through all the records. Select employees. Something has gone wrong with your SQL profiler. I'll close this. I'll start a new one. SQL profiler. So I'll say F5. So can you tell me, see, we have how many departments? 6 departments, right? Can you tell me how many queries get executed? Six plus one, very good. One department, and for each department, one execution. So if you have n departments, then you'll have n plus one query executions. This is lazy loading. This is supported in 2.2 and 3.0, not in 2.0. This was not supported in 2.0. So wherever we need it, we are loading it. So anyway, but normally this is not the best practice to go with your lazy loading on demand. So you can do this lazy loading manually, and we can call it as explicit loading. Now if I comment this, now let me execute. We do not get the records. Now what I can do, this lazy loading, you can do it manually. You can say d dot, or my db context, my db context dot entry of d, for this d object, dot collection for x gives rise to x dot employees. I think this is the correct code. Let me check for that. Exactly. Dot load. That's it. We are not going to install any package. We are not going to say use lazy loading. What we are going to do, we are going to load explicitly whenever we need it. We need employees at this point for this D, right? So we are going to load explicitly at this point. So my DB context dot entry of D dot collection. Why? Because we have a collection here. So list of employees dot load. Now it will work in the same sense, number of hits will be same, but we are doing this explicitly. So lazy loading will do it implicitly, but we are doing it explicitly wherever we need it. So we call it as explicit loading. New tracking, connect, run. Full screen, clear everything. Now I'll say F10. So we got departments. Now I'll say F10. Now you see this, earlier it was executing a query here, but now it will not execute. It will execute wherever you need it. So it should execute a query here. You see that it has executed the query with department one. So this is your explicit loading. I'll say F5. That's it. I hope you got the point. It is same as lazy loading, but you are loading it explicitly. This is for collection. Now you should get a doubt. What if we have a single record like employee loading department? That is this case. I'll copy this. Paste it here. I will uncomment it. I don't want to go for eager loading. But what I want, iterating through it, whenever I need it, I will say db context or my db context dot entry of E dot. Now earlier we have a collection, now it is not a collection, it is a reference, single record reference of x gives rise to x dot department dot load. Are you all with me? Got the difference between reference and collection? List of employees. You want to load a department, so it is a reference. List of employees. You want to load a department, reference. Department. You want to load list of employees, then it is collection. Simple thing. Property type is collection, so it is collection. It is reference, so it is reference. Now let me execute. It should display the department name as well. Is this clear?
Yes.
Do anybody have any kind of doubt? You can I'll give you 5 minutes to type in all your doubts, then I'll take one doubt after the other. So before that, let me show this PPT and finish it off my PPT reading task. Eager loading versus explicit loading versus lazy loading. I hope you understood all these things. Now, eager loading, if we write a select query on parent table, it not only loads parent table records, but also automatically loads its related table record. And it is achieved with the help of include. Automatically means if you write include, it will load. Explicit loading, if you write a select query on parent table, it loads only parent table records. And the child table records are loaded explicitly with the help of collection or reference method whenever we access the related tables with navigation property. So these are all in my own words, simplified definitions. Lazy loading, you go with this. If you write a select query on the parent table, it loads only parent table records, and the child table records are loaded automatically whenever we access the related tables with navigation properties. Not supported in Entity Framework 4 2.0 and supported in 2.2 plus. You have source code snippets as well. This is this. This is what, this is what, this. Include, eager loading. Entry dot collection, explicit loading. This is your lazy loading. Use lazy loading proxy. You need not to do anything. It will load automatically at this point of time. That's it. If you have any doubts, I'm going to give you 5 minutes. Write all your queries in the chat box. Then I'll take one after the other. Yes, for explicit loading, you need not to install any package. Yeah, we are recording, no problem. You are not adding any department ID in explicit loading. How I get the data, you write. Okay. You type in all the questions, I will take at the end. Fine. Okay. See, enough for the questions. My email ID is md.manzoorahmad@gmail.com. You can send me any more questions. So I'll just try to take these questions, whatever I have. You're not adding any department ID in explicit loading. How it gets the data? See, in our explicit loading, we are not adding department ID. That is right. But E has got department ID, right? In employee table, when it loads employee, it has employee ID, employee name, and all those things along with department ID as foreign key. So it is taking from there. I hope you got that answer. Next, department list. Again, list of employee will have department object. Can you please explain the use case or scenario when, see, this is again circular. Yes, it will have again, that is fine. When we have to go with these three different types of loading scenarios. See, I have shown just now, I have gone with your eager loading. So when, see again, when you have to choose between number of hits to the database and the object size, scenarios what we did for immediate mode and deferred mode. As I told you, can you tell me how many number of queries it will execute? One is for employees. 10 employees, so one. And here it will load 10 more queries, so 10 plus 1, 11 employees. If department is same for other employees, so it will not load again because it has loaded. So in simple words, here you will have more number of hits to the server, same. Whereas if you go with this dot include, X gives rise to X dot department. Here there will be only one hit. We need not to go for this. But object size is heavy. Same thing. But you see this. This is eager loading, immediate mode of query execution. You have both the combinations. I hope you got the answer is same what we discussed for eager loading and that. Number of hits in your explicit loading is high, whereas object size is less. Whereas in your eager loading, number of hits to the server is less, but object size will be heavy. So if you have less amount of data, go with eager loading. If you have a huge amount of data, then you go with explicit loading. If you have less number of concurrent hits, go for explicit loading. If you have a huge number of concurrent hits, go for eager loading. Same thing. I hope this question, the answer is clear for Robin. Lazy loading package is not supported on core, is only supported on core only. Lazy loading package is supported on core as well as on your framework. No problem. Circular referencing, you said you would let us know how to avoid it. Okay. Out of syllabus question. What all topics remain in entity framework other than videos you showed today in training? Can you please post your email ID? I have posted. Was lazy loading there before entity framework core? No. If I have to skip first 10 records from data set and display the how to achieve it, you have a skip. If you say skip, you have skip method. I think we have skip. Answer is in your question. Ranjan, welcome. If we include more child objects by eager loading, Because performance, if yes, how to resolve it? If we include more child objects by equal loading, it causes performance issue. If yes, how to resolve it? Again, same answer is same. If object is very heavy, don't go for this equal loading. Go for explicit wherever you need it. Okay, at last I will try to solve that problem that is your circular referencing problem. Anyway, I thought of not to discuss it, but you people are showing more interest, so I'm also getting an interest. So I'll say F10. Now you see this employee has got department. Department has got employee. Employee has got department. Department has got employee. So this is circular referencing. So here it is fine. But when you try to convert this into JSON data, then it will throw an error. So a very infinite string, it will become into an infinite string. So what I can do, solution for this. Before I say dot to list, I will say dot select x gives rise to x dot. We are taking employee, right? X gives rise to new employee. You can define the columns here. You can define the columns here, whatever you want. Employee ID equals to x dot employee ID. Next, first name equals to x dot first name. Last name equals to x dot last name. Defining all the columns, comma, gender equals to x dot gender. See, when you want to select only few columns out of all the columns, then you do this. I hope you know very well. So I'm going to show you few more things, don't worry. Salary and DID equals to x dot DID. Then I'll say department equals to x dot department. So it will stop here. If you do this explicitly, if you define the columns, and it should stop at level one. Now I'll put a breakpoint here. You can see that. Now you see these employees. Got employee and department. And in department, employees is null. There is no more circular referencing. I'm asking them to stop at this first level of department. That's it. So if you want all everything, you can go to this manjudatrainer.com. And here you have all the technologies that you want to learn. And I'm looking for entity framework. For entity framework core, we have all these topics. Apart from this, there are a lot of things. So we have discussed these two things. These are the topics that we discussed. The major important thing is class design techniques. So we have a lot of scenarios in this. You can choose, you learn how to design the classes. And you have writing raw SQLs. If there is some information that you want to extract but you cannot define in your SQL Server entity framework, then you want to write your own query, and how to work with stored procedures, how to write transactions, how to implement three-layered architectures and or n-layered architecture, and how to have your childs, subchilds, including subchilds, including siblings. So the complex scenario. So all those things you can get it from this course. Its actual price is $20. But what I have done, the complete learning path for MVC developers, I have made it with 50% off, and I'm going to share it in the WhatsApp group. I have shared it just now. It is in the WhatsApp group. The complete learning path with 50% off. And one more thing that you would really love, blogs. You have all your lambda expression and query expressions with almost all the combinations. What I did it for nearly, I think we have it for 36 queries. This is what I'm going to share it on WhatsApp group. This too. This is the learning path you can see. Level one. Those who want to become MVC web developers, MVC core, full stack MVC core web developers. They should start with SQL Server, go for C#.NET, Entity Framework Core, HTML5, JavaScript, MVC, then live project on MVC. So almost all the courses are of some $10 each with 50% discount. And this is your level two, where you have Web API Core, TypeScript, Angular 8, and live project. And it is also, but this is not for $10, but I'm giving it for 50% off. This is level two, where you'll become a full stack web developer with Angular 8 live projects and everything. And here you can see you have a lot of queries, like select star from department, how you write lambda expression, how you write query expression, column aliasing, how you write it, top two, how you take order by clause, group by clause, less than, greater than, ranges. So I have done joins, sum of, average, groups, lot of things I have done. I have nearly, you know, converted 36 queries in your lambda expression and in your query expression and lambda expression. So you can refer even this. So that's it. This is all about our today's sessions. And once again, I request, see, this is a kind of encouraging point for me. If you give me the feedback or your reviews at this link, I'll be really happy. It encourages me a lot. And Robin's question also, I want to answer the last question. How we created the code snippet? See, we have an extension. That is this snippet generator Visual Studio. This is your snippet in Visual Studio Code. Sorry, not this. Snippet generator. Not this. Visual Studio snippet generator. Snippet generator. So there is an extension. I'll just see where, yeah, this is this Visual Studio Code snippet generator. You install this extension. Once you install the extension, what you can do, for example, I want to reuse this. Fine, I want to reuse this. I want to make a snippet of this. Select this, right click, export as a snippet. Visual Studio got hang because it has been running for past 2.5 hours. We are running this. So this tool will help you out in that. Yes, it should work in all versions. I have tried with almost. So right click, you say export, then it should work. Yes. Enterprise, of course, it will work. So that's it for our today's session. Thank you very much. Thanks for your time. Even on working day, you have taken out time. So nice to have you all in the session. And I'll be really happy to have your feedbacks and suggestions with the link that I have forwarded you. And of course, I'm going to share the code, PPT, as well as the video on the same page from where you registered. And I'm going to share it in the group as well. No worries. So that's it for today. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Manzoor.
Welcome.